Praise the Lord, saints. My name is Pastor Evangelist Deborah Tate. I'm with Royal Diadem Internet Ministry, and we are the crown gem of Cleveland, Ohio, bringing to you the very best in gospel music. I want to thank you for clicking in and joining me for another Morning Cup of Word here on Live365.com, station the crown gem. We come on Monday through Fridays from 12 o'clock to 1 o'clock a.m. Then I come back on from 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock a.m. That's Eastern Standard Time. So again, it's at 12 o'clock to 1 o'clock a.m. And then from 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock a.m. That's Eastern Standard Time. Give people a chance to hear the teaching. Amen, amen. And that's Monday through Friday. Our Morning Cup trivial question is this. Why did the king of Egypt tell the Hebrew midwives to do with the newborn baby? And then questions number two, or newborn babies. And then question number two is, why did the Hebrew midwives not do what the Pharaoh told them to do? Okay, and I'm going to give you the answers at the end of the first half of this podcast. Now let's go to the throne room of grace, because we got a lot of things we've got to pray about, especially this situation with Korea hooking up with Russia. That's not good. Father, we come before you right now in the mighty and majestic name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we're asking, Lord God, that you'll send forth your angels and encamp them all around our borders, Lord God. Father, protect your people from California to New York, from Alaska to Hawaii. Protect and shield and bring home our servicemen and women safely in the name of Jesus. Father, give our Congress people and our president unity in the name of Jesus. Father, help us to focus in what's important for America in Jesus' name. Now, Father, let the blood of your son Jesus cover us, cleanse us, and forgive us, Lord God, for turning our backs on you in the name of Jesus. And Father, we promise to give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor in the mighty and majestic name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We're going to get back on talking about covenant, because it's so important that we know what a covenant is and that we understand that there's two types of covenants. There's a conditional covenant and then there's an unconditional covenant. And in the Old Testament, it talks about five different types of covenant, and we're going to try to go through all of them, okay? So Exodus, let's listen to Exodus 6. Chapter 6. Keep it locked right here.
Then see the lock. Lord said unto Moses,
Now shalt thou see what I will do to Pharaoh. For with a strong hand shall he let them go, and with a strong hand shall he drive them out of his land.
And God spake unto Moses and said unto him,
I am the Lord, and I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty. But by my name Jehovah was I not known to them. And I have also established my covenant with them, to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage, wherein they were strangers. And I have also heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage, and I have remembered my covenant. Wherefore say unto the children of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will rid you out of their bondage, and I will redeem you with a stretched out arm and with great judgments. And I will take you to me for a people, and I will be to you a God. And ye shall know that I am the Lord your God, which bringeth you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. And I will bring you in unto the land, concerning the which I did swear to give it to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And I will give it you for an heritage. I am the Lord.
And Moses spake so unto the children of Israel. But they hearkened not unto Moses for anguish of spirit and for cruel bondage. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying,
Go in, speak unto Pharaoh king of Egypt, that he let the children of Israel go out of his land.
And Moses spake before the Lord, saying, Behold, the children of Israel have not hearkened unto me. How then shall Pharaoh hear me, who am of uncircumcised lips? And the Lord spake unto Moses and unto Aaron, and gave them a charge unto the children of Israel, and unto Pharaoh king of Egypt, to bring the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. These be the heads of their fathers' houses. The sons of Reuben, the firstborn of Israel, Hanok and Pallu, Hezron and Carmi. These be the families of Reuben. And the sons of Simeon, Jemuel and Jamin, and Ohad and Jachin, and Zohar and Shaul, the son of a Canaanitish woman. These are the families of Simeon. And these are the names of the sons of Levi according to their generations, Gershon and Kohath and Merari. And the years of the life of Levi were 137 years. The sons of Gershon, Libni and Shimei according to their families. And the sons of Kohath, Amram and Izhar and Hebron and Uzziel. And the years of the life of Kohath were 133 years. And the sons of Merari, Mahali and Mushai. These are the families of Levi according to their generations. And Amram took him Jochebed, his father's sister, to wife, and she bare him Aaron and Moses. And the years of the life of Amram were 137 years. And the sons of Izhar, Korah and Nepheg and Zichri. And the sons of Uzziel, Mishael and Elzaphan and Zithri. And Aaron took him Elisheba, daughter of Aminadab, sister of Naashon, to wife. And she bare him Nadab, and Abihu, Eleazar, and Ithamar. And the sons of Korah, Aser, and Elkanah, and Abisaph. These are the families of the Korahites. And Eleazar, Aaron's son, took him one of the daughters of Putiel to wife. And she bare him Phinehas. These are the heads of the fathers of the Levites, according to their families. These are that Aaron and Moses, to whom the Lord said,
Bring out the children of Israel from the land of Egypt, according to their armies.
These are they which spake to Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to bring out the children of Israel from Egypt. These are that Moses and Aaron. And it came to pass on the day when the Lord spake unto Moses in the land of Egypt, that the Lord spake unto Moses, saying,
I am the Lord. Speak thou unto Pharaoh, king of Egypt, all that I say unto thee.
And Moses said before the Lord,
Lord, behold, I am of uncircumcised lips, and how shall Pharaoh hearken unto me?
May the Lord add a blessing to the readers and hearers, and especially the doers of His word, in Jesus' name. We're still talking about covenant. I want you to understand what covenant is all about. As you see in Exodus chapter 6, God is letting Moses know that he will see what he is going to do to Pharaoh. God is letting Moses know that he has a lot of power. In fact is, God has great power. And God is letting Moses know, I will use my great power against Pharaoh. And he will, now he might, he will let my people go. So, tell the children, go down there and talk to them. Let them know they got to be ready to leave. Because when it's time for them to leave, it's going to be because I'm going to use tremendous force on Pharaoh. But even though Moses has done seen a burning bush, Moses done heard this bush talk to him. Moses has thrown down his rod and God is turning into a serpent, and then told him to pick it up by the tail. God told him to put his hand in his chest, and his hand came out and was leprosy, and he put his hand back in and it was healed. God is showing Moses his power. Moses still is questioning God. He don't want to do it. He does not want to answer the call. And his call is to go into Egypt and to win others to a saving knowledge of who Jehovah is, who God is. Because remember, yesterday we talked about the name of a title yesterday was, Who is the Lord that I should obey His voice? Well, today we're going to find out that He is I am that I am. That's who He is. That's the name of our title for today. I am that I am. That's the name of our title, because that's who He is. He's just I am. The Bible lets him know. He says, I am the Lord. He said, he tells Moses, I appeared to Abraham, I appeared to Isaac, and I appeared to Jacob. They call me God all powerful. And he said, but they didn't, still they didn't know who I was. And he wants them to know, I made an agreement, I made a covenant with them that I would give them some land, that I would that your people would become a great nation. I made a covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I made a covenant with them. I have made an agreement with them. And I promised to give them the land of Canaan. And they lived in that land, but it was not their own. But now I have heard their painful cries, and I know that they are slaves in Egypt. And I remember my covenant. I remember my agreement. This is what Exodus chapter 6 is talking about. So what he does, he wants Moses to go back. Now, Moses has been away for a long time. He's been away about 40 years. Moses is an old man. He don't care anything about politics. He don't care anything about what they're doing. He don't care about what the new phase, what's going on or nothing. He's content. He's never had anything. That's the highest he ever gotten. And then that didn't even, he found out that didn't belong to him. He's living with his wife's father. He's got his wife's father stuff. He's taking care of that stuff. So he's pretty done laid low. But I'm here to tell you, God doesn't bring you out of bondage for you to let your friends stay in bondage. I'm not saying to go in there and force your religion on them, you know, because the Bible says he that wins souls is wise. And the Bible tells us to be wise as serpents, but gentle as doves. So you can't force them. But there are things you can do for them, like pray for them. When you get a chance, drop a little nugget, you know, a little gem concerning the word. Don't force it on them, but, you know, drop a little, you know, give them a little something from the word of God. Have your relationship right with God. And walk with God before them. So God wants Moses to go to the children of Israel, and he wants Moses to tell them that he is the Lord and that he will save them, and that they will no longer be slaves of the Egyptian, that he's going to use his great mighty power to make them free. He says he's going to bring a terrible judgment upon the Egyptians. He lets them know, he says, you're going to be my people, and I've always been your God, and I'm your Lord. I'm your Lord God, and I know what it's going to take to make you free from Egypt. And I made a great promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I promised them that I would give them a fertile, spacious, milk and honey land, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to give you that land. It's going to be yours because I am the Lord. So the Bible lets us know that Moses told this to the Israelites, but the people would not listen to him. They wouldn't listen to him. And Moses kept trying to tell them. He said, I'm going to go tell Pharaoh that he must let the children of Israel leave. And the Lord told him, he says, well, the children of Israel will hearken to your voice. He said, but Moses, he said, Pharaoh won't. And sure enough, as soon as Moses went to talk to Pharaoh, Pharaoh said this. He said, we talked about this yesterday. He said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? And we talk about what the word who meant and what the word voice meant. And I told you, when we left off yesterday, I told you, I said, there's three voices people told me when I was first born again. Three voices you have to learn how to recognize. One, you got to recognize the enemy, Satan's voice. You got to know your voice. And last but not least, and most of all, the most important voice you got to know is God's voice. And how do you know God's voice? It's by reading his word. That's how you know God's voice, is by reading his word. That's who you find out who you are. I told you day before yesterday on Tuesday's broadcast, I said, when I was in college, they taught me how to write when I was at OSU. This was like 30 years ago when I was at OSU, but I still remember what I was taught. Don't you remember when people give you important things? Do you not remember? I do. When people tell me important things, I carry it with me. And some things I've been carrying with me, that people, advice that people have given me about 20, 30, 40 years ago, I still hold on to that advice they give me. When people give you good advice, I'm going to tell you what some of the mothers used to tell me in the church. They said, put it on the shelf because you don't know when you're going to need it. So this is some advice that I was told when I was in college, that when you write, your writing should have a voice. In other words, your character, your personality traits should be within your writings, so that it, no matter what you write, if you got a regular a regular person that reads your blogs, even if they don't see your name up there, they can say, oh, that's Debbie's writing, or oh, that's John's writing. Well, how you know that's Debbie's writing? Because when she writes, she always says this, and she writes like that. She has a certain style. Well, it's the same way with the Bible. And when you start reading your Bible on a regular basis, you'll start recognizing the voice of God. I'm going to tell you something. You'll recognize that voice in everyday living. That's why it's important to read the Word of God. And then you'll be able to decipher what is the enemy and what is your thoughts and what is coming from the Lord. But if you're not reading the Bible, if you're not reading God's word, you're not going to distinguish or be able to distinguish Satan's voice, your voice, and God's voice. You're not going to be able to tell which one is which. You're always going to be confused and muddled. You're not going to know what to do in certain circumstances or situations because you have not studied the word of God so that you can recognize his voice. So when I was in college, that's what they taught me. They said, Debbie, when you write a book, you got to develop a voice. I said, what? You got to develop a voice. Sinners know this. You got to develop a voice. See, there's a lot to writing. You got to develop a voice. So that no matter if somebody just found a page, laying on the road, and they just found a page of a book you wrote, they could pick that one page up and say, oh, Deborah wrote this. Or, oh, John wrote this. Even, that's how scholars were able to decipher which disciple, as knows as a decipher, which disciples wrote certain parts of the New Testament, because they knew their personality. They knew their voice. For example, Luke, the physician Luke in the Bible, one of Jesus' 12 disciples. Scholars were able to read Luke and then read Acts and say, this is Luke wrote this. So how you know Luke wrote it? I mean, this is what, 2,000 years ago. How you know Luke wrote Acts? Because we recognize his style. That's his voice. We recognize the way he writes, the way he does things when he has a pen in his hand and a piece of paper. We know that is Luke that wrote Acts. We know that John wrote John, and we know that John wrote Revelations. Well, how do you know? Because he has a certain style. He has a certain way in which he writes. Well, it's the same thing with God. See, God is, and even more so, because God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He don't change. He don't change. His word remains the same. He's not going to treat me no better, no special than he treated people 2 and 3 and 4 and 5,000 years ago. He judges everybody equally and everybody the same. And to me, that's a good morning cup of word. That's what he does. That's who he is. So when Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? And then he said this. He said, I don't know the Lord. He told the truth. He says, I don't know the Lord. He said, and I'm not letting the people go. And we talked about this yesterday, how Moses didn't know who he was. Because the first thing he said is, who am I? But see, now God's getting ready to show them who he is. He said, y'all knew me. He said, you knew me. He said, first of all, he said, I am the Lord. And I appeared before Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. then you didn't know me. He said, then you didn't know me. You know me as that, as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You knew me from their experience. You knew who I was through them. He said, but my name is Jehovah. He said, I appeared. In verse 3, he said, and I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty. But my name, Jehovah, was I not known to them. He says, I'm going to show you a part of me. You're going to know who I am in a way that they never knew me. Yes, I appear to them. I appear to Abraham. I appear to Isaac. I appeared unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty. But by my name, Jehovah, was I not known to them. Then he tells them this in verse 4. He says, I have also established my covenant with them. And this is what we're getting ready to get back into. To give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage, wherein they were strangers. Now he said, now I have heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage. And I have remembered my covenant. He says, I have remembered my covenant. I have remembered the agreement that I made with them. And that's what we're going to talk about. And remember, the name of our topic is I am that I am. I am. Who are you, Lord? I am. I'm Jehovah. I'm going to show you a part of me. This is what he's telling Moses. I'm going to show all 3 million people who I am. I'm going to show the nation of Israel who I am. Now, I know they talked about me and they heard of me. And when you go to them, you tell them the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob sent you. But you tell them also, I'm getting ready to show them something. I'm getting ready to show Pharaoh something. And I'm getting ready to show you something. Because this little puny man talking about who is the Lord that I should obey his voice. I'm going to show you who I am and why you should obey my voice. And that's what we're going to talk about. Because in order to understand what God is trying to do with the nation of Israel, you're going to have to understand what a covenant is. And in order to understand the Bible, period, and what you have in Jesus Christ, you're going to have to understand covenant and what it is to have a covenant. The Old Testament is just a term, as I mentioned last week, that comes from the Latin word covenant. And this term came to be known from Paul and the other early Christians who distinguished between the old covenant that God made with Israel concerning, number one, the promise of their own land. Number two, promised them that they would become a great nation. Number three, God promised that all men would be blessed through Abraham and through his seed. And when I said that God promised to bless all nations through Abraham's family line, what I'm saying is that God promised Abraham that the Messiah, the Savior of the world, would be born through their genealogy. The new covenant would be established through Jesus Christ, which is a promise of restoration and reconciliation of mankind, period, with God. Therefore, what we're going to learn is that when we get an understanding of what the word testament, which is the same word as covenant, when we get that understanding, then we're going to learn also what does it mean to have a covenant. How do we have a covenant? And we have to really get an understanding that unless there is a shedding of blood, there is no covenant. The word covenant also means to cut. And I put that up on Facebook this week, and I put it up on Google Plus, and I'm going to put it up again. We have to understand that a covenant is binding. It is a solemn agreement made by two or more individuals or parties. A covenant is about making a vow to do or to keep from doing a specific or certain thing. A covenant is a compact. It is an agreement among members of a church to defend or to maintain its policy, its doctrines, and its practices in Jesus Christ accordingly to the word of God, which is a covenant. Okay? Accordingly to the word of God. But see, one of the reasons why people can't understand why us Christians don't believe in homosexuality. We, they thinking we trying to judge. No, we're not trying to judge. We have a covenant with God where we are not allowed to do that. Or abortions. President Obama, you're trying to force us to break us into disobeying God's and the covenant that we have with him. Because yesterday I talked about Deuteronomy chapter 28. And Deuteronomy, the whole chapter, I read it. I read the whole chapter. Why? Because a lot of people going around singing, we're blessed in the cities, we're blessed in the fields, we blessed when we come and go, casting down. You know, they just go on and on and on. But they don't read the other parts where God says, if you do not obey my commands, and his command is a covenant, then all these curses are going to come upon you. So when we say we are honoring God's covenant, we can't do this, we can't, a certain type of birth control, we just can't purchase with our money because we're under a covenant. There's just, we can't service people that may want to have the same sex thing. Now, there's no law that's stopping them from doing what they're doing. There's no law for anybody stopping them from doing what they're doing. And anyway, the Lord told me, he said, the church need to quit fretting over same-sex marriage. He said, quit fretting because it's still not a marriage, because it doesn't symbolize what the church is. Now, if they want to think it is a marriage and if that's what they want to believe, go for it. But it ain't. Because number one, in order for it to symbolize something that is holy, in order for it to symbolize God and symbolize a real marriage, there has to be a father that gives the bride away to the groom. I'm going to say it again. In order for it to be a real covenant, and a marriage is a covenant, and there has to be a shedding of blood, okay? The woman has to be a virgin. The man has to be a virgin. When they get together, the hymen is broken. There is a shedding of blood. Okay, I'm going to keep it real with you. This is a covenant. This is a marriage. And she has to be given away by her father or a male figure, father figure, has to give her away to the groom. Jesus Christ died for our sins. He shed his blood on Calvary's cross. The Father gave us, we, the church, is the bride. Jesus is the groom. The Father presented us, the bride, to his son Jesus, the groom. So no matter what you do or what you want to call it, if you want to call it a marriage, go right for it. But in reality, it's not a marriage, because the father has to give the bride to the groom. And there must be a shedding of blood in order for there to be a covenant. And I know a lot of people are not going to like that, but that's how it is. I'm just telling you what the word says. I want you to understand what it means to have a covenant. And you want the presence of God. You want God to tabernacle with you and your husband. You want this. We're going to take a break right now. And I promised you that I was going to give you the answers to our morning cup trivial question, which was, why did the king of Egypt tell the Hebrew midwives to do with the newborn babies? That was to kill them. And that's in Exodus chapter 1, 16. And question number two, why did the Hebrew midwives not do what the Pharaoh told them to do? Because they feared God more than Pharaoh. And that's Exodus 1, verse 17. Keep it locked right here. Let's go into a musical interlude. I'm your host, Pastor Evangelist Deborah Tate. You're listening to A Morning Cup of Words, Selah. Praise the Lord, saints. My name is Pastor Evangelist Deborah Tate. You're listening to A Morning Cup of Word here on Live365.com station, The Crown Gem. We're talking about covenant. The name of our topic tonight is I Am That I Am. This is what God told Moses. We talked about yesterday how Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? Well, God's getting ready to show him who he is. Amen, amen. And we come on weekdays, Monday through Friday. We have a new time, and I'm kind of like splitting up the 2 hours that I used to do. We come on from 12 o'clock to 1 o'clock a.m. That's Eastern Standard Time. And then we come back on again from 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock a.m. That's Eastern Standard Time too as well. And what we're trying to do is, you know, I'm trying to find the right time because I'm battling cancer. I need your prayers. and some days I have to go get chemo. And so I'm trying to schedule this program around the times that I have to go to, you know, chemo, so that there isn't any interruptions. Amen, amen. And like I said, I'm in need of your prayer. Continue to pray for me, and I continue to pray for you. But we've been talking about covenant and why it's so important to have a covenant. And what God wanted Israel to understand what a covenant is. And this is exactly what he's telling Moses. He's saying, Moses, look, I got a covenant with your people. And a covenant is a binding solemn agreement made by two or more individuals. A covenant is about making a vow to do or keep from doing a specific or certain thing. A covenant is a compact agreement among members of a church to defend and to maintain its policies, its doctrines, its practice concerning Jesus Christ, accordingly to the Word of God. And as I was mentioning, some things we just can't do because we have a covenant with God. And the Bible tells us what we can do and what we cannot do. That's why I can automatically say, thank you, Lord. You know, if I need a bill paid, I can just say, thank you. Why? Because he said, if I seek his kingdom and his righteousness, all these things would be added unto me. And then I also told you that some covenants are conditional and some are not conditional. And the Bible will let you know which ones are conditional. Because some people think they can live any kind of way and God is still going to bless them. No, God is not going to bless you if you're not living according to his word. That's why when Chick-fil-A says, well, I believe in that a husband and a woman makes a marriage. Well, he has to say that because he's in a covenant agreement with God. And the Word of God says that. Now, you can change all you want to. You can change the Bible. You can try to twist it around any way you want to. But it's still going to be what God's Word, still going to be his Word. He says heaven and earth may pass away. He said, but my Word remaineth forever. He said, as the snow and the rain come down from heaven, water the earth and give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. He says, my word shall not return unto me void. This is what he says. And like I told you, they can call it whatever they want to call it. But it's not a marriage. Not in God's eyesight. Now, it can be marriage through the law. But a marriage, let me put it to you like this. Even if it's a man and a woman, if the marriage ain't done God's way, it ain't a marriage. He doesn't recognize it. That's why there's a high divorce rate. In order for there to be a marriage, a perfect marriage, the father must give the bride to the groom. And the father has given the church, which symbolizes a bride, to the groom, who is Jesus. And that's just how it is. The covenant is the party to whom the promise is set down, the covenant, and the covenanter, that is God, and the covenantee, that is us. And I want you to understand this, that God is under no obligation to do anything for us that will benefit us, because we are the ones that broke away from him. So he does not owe us anything. But if you listen to the audio, you remember he made a promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that number one, he would give them their own land. Number two, that the child from his loins would become a great nation. And number three, that all nations would be blessed through him. And God so far has kept his promises. He has kept them all the way. He has honored his covenant with mankind. The Old and the New Testament is a book of agreement where God is the covenanter and we are the covenantee. God has given us this book of agreement in order that we may know what to do and in what order and in the way that he chooses that pleases him. Remember, the Bible communicates to us the will of God. It allows us to hear his voice, know his decisions concerning his plan for salvation for us. The Bible also shares with us the day of reckoning of future sinners and the devil. The Bible speaks about the devil and sinful man's destruction. Therefore, those of us who strive to live for God, we are told God's secrets. God reveals to us his plans like he did with Abraham. And we talked about that. We talked about Genesis, how God showed us how he was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Well, now God is showing Moses exactly what he's going to do to Pharaoh if Pharaoh don't get it together here soon. He says, with a forceful hand, he says, I'm going to go after him. He said, with a forceful hand, I'm going to go after him. It didn't surprise God that Pharaoh had that type of answer. Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? And that's what some of us do. Some of us in our lifestyles say, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? Our lifestyles actually speak louder than words. Some of our lifestyles say, I don't know the Lord, and I'm not going to obey his voice. I'm going to do what I want to do. And as I was saying, how do you know the voice of God? How are you able to distinguish who God is? You have to read your word. Because it is in reading your word that you will be able to distinguish who God's voice, what his voice is. And God lets Moses know. He says, I have heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage. And then he said this, I have remembered my covenant. I remember what I promised. And a lot of people say, well, how did they end up in Egyptian bondage? I told you, because of what Joseph's brothers did, they brought a generational curse on themselves, spirit of slavery. When they sold their brother into slavery, they sold themselves into slavery. God can't have 11 tribes in Canaan and the 12th one in Egypt. That's not fulfilling his promise. He has to have all of them. All of them have to go. All of them have to be there. Because the promise was to Abraham and his seed. The promise was to Isaac, Jacob, and Abraham and their seed. So God had to keep his promise. He had to do what he had to do to get all of them together so he could bring all of them together to the promised land. And he had to, because he had established his covenant. And that's the first thing that comes out of his mouth. He tells Moses, he said, now you're going to see what I will do to Pharaoh. He said, with a strong hand, he must let them go. Now he's going to, but he's going to have to, because with a strong hand, he shall drive them out of his land. Because God knew, he said, you can see what I'm getting ready to do. And then he says this. He says, I want you to let them know who I am. I appeared unto Abraham. I appeared unto Isaac. I appeared unto Jacob as God Almighty. He said, but my name was Lord. He said, my name was Lord. My name was Jehovah. He said, but I was not known to them. He said, I also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage in which they were strangers. And he says, and likewise, I have heard the groanings of the sons of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage. And then he says it again. I remember my covenant. It would be nice if a lot of us would remember our covenants that we have with God. But a lot of us don't do that. A lot of us don't remember the covenant that we have with God. We forget. As soon as we get a little bit on our feet, we forget what we promised God when we was in trouble, when we was in jail, or when we was with that crazy man or with that crazy woman, or when we had a disease. I've seen people that was on their deathbed and God raised them up out of the deathbed. God healed their bodies, and they went back into sin. Instead of spending the rest of their lives serving God, they went back into sin. We sometimes have to remember where God has brought us from, and we too need to think and thank of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for us. And then our souls will cry out, hallelujah, I thank and praise God for saving me. But we don't do that. We don't do that. We have a tendency to want to do what we want to do, irregardless of what God tells us to do. But they totally forgot what a covenant was, that they had a covenant. They didn't rehearse it. They didn't constantly remind themselves that, oh, we got a covenant with God, so we can't do this. they did what they wanted to do irregardless. They just didn't want to remember. But when we're not faithful, you will find that God is faithful. When we forget what we're supposed to do, we will find that God does not forget what he is supposed to do, but that he is faithful. He never forgets. He is a faithful God. Even when we forget to do what we know we're supposed to do, even when we forget the covenant and the agreement that we made with God, if you get me out of jail, I promise I will never do this again. If you get me out of jail, I promise I'll straighten up. Oh, Lord, please don't let me have a sexually transmitted disease. Lord, I promise I'll wait until you send me the right man or the right woman. Oh, Lord, please, if you just, I know I was drinking, Lord God, but if you just get me out of this situation, Lord God, I promise you I'll live for you. I'll be holy, Lord God. I promise you I'll do things better the next time. And then when God fixes the situation, what do? We go back and we forget our covenant with God. We do that in marriages. That's why Christianity has the highest divorce rate, because we forget that the covenant that we made to God, we didn't make the covenant with our spouse. We made our covenant with God when we got married. But some of us have a tendency to forget, and we do what we want to do, or we treat our spouses mean, thinking that they're going to stay with us just because they're supposed to. We don't take in consideration that we ought to be kind to them and not mean and abusive. We don't think about that. So we see in 6 that God has not forgotten his covenant with Israel. He's aiming to do what he said he was going to do, and that was to bring them out of Egyptian bondage. This is what he said he was going to do, and this is what he's done. And like I said, a lot of people say, well, how did they end up in that situation? Sometimes a person can come under a curse that they're not personally responsible for, that they have inherited either through their ancestors or through someone else. The Israelite children had inherited the slavery curse because of what, like I said, Joseph's brothers selling Joseph into slavery caused their offsprings to suffer the same fate. You can find out that asthma, cancer, obesity, alcoholism, heart condition can come from generational curses. Problems can come before you were even born or even thought of, before your parents met, all because of what their parents did. Sometimes it skips over a generation and lands on another generation. And like I said yesterday, many quote Deuteronomy chapter 28, how they're blessed. But they forget the rest of that chapter about the curses that will come upon them if they're not obedient to the word of God. People nowadays don't want to hear that stuff. I had one person tell me, Debbie, you know, you can't tell grown people what to do. You, even if you're 100% correct, you can't tell grown people what to do. The church has to understand there are consequences when we sin, not only to us, but to our children, even before they're born. People going through all types of trouble, bad personal life, finances, businesses going under, constantly being laid off, sicknesses, disease, and death. All they have to do is come to Jesus. People fail to understand. They have stopped teaching this in the church, that when a father or a mother commits a sin, their children pick it up. This is what had happened. There is already weakness in us to sin from birth, the old sinful nature. That's in the father and the mother is passed down onto us, and then we pass it down to our children. And if you ever did the look up the genealogy of the Canaanites and everybody else, you will find that that's to be true. Right now, we're getting ready to go into another musical interlude. I'm your host. My name is Pastor Evangelist Deborah Tate. You're listening to A Morning Cup of Word. And then when we come back after listening to these couple of songs, we're going to do our altar call. Okay, all right. You're listening to A Morning Cup of Word. Name of our topic is I Am That I Am. In other words, God is getting ready to show Pharaoh. He can ready to show the devil who he is. He's getting ready to show Israel who he is. And he's getting ready to show Moses who he is in God. And to me, that's a good morning cup of word. Selah. Well, This is Pastor Evangelist Deborah Tate, and we're getting ready to come to a conclusion to our topic, I Am That I Am. We're going to talk a little bit more about Exodus. We're going to listen starting Monday, Exodus chapter 7. So if you, over the weekend, if you get a chance, read Exodus chapter 7. And I want to let you know that God wants you to know that you are a sinner and that you're in need of a Savior. And that acceptance or refusal will determine your destiny. It can determine your destiny now, and it can determine your destiny in the future. You need Jesus. We all need Him. And He has a covenant that He's made with you. I'm talking to those that have backslidden, that have left the Lord for whatever reason. I want you to know that God loves you, and He wants you back. And that's just the bottom line. And you belong to Him. Amen, amen. You belong to Him. And to me, that's a good morning cup of words. That no matter what mistakes we make, God will not forget the covenant that He made with us. Amen, amen. So what I want you to do right now is I want you to just take a pause for the calls. And just say, Lord Jesus, please come into my life. I admit that I've done wrong. I admit that I'm in need of a Savior. I admit that my life has been all messed up and that I haven't done everything the way I should have been doing it. And Lord, I'm asking you to give me another chance in Jesus' name. And if you said that, then what I want you to do is I want you to, you know, go to my Facebook, facebook.com, Deborah Tate. And say, and join me there and say, because I put up postings and stuff like that, and say, Pastor Tate, I have accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. You can also Twitter me at The Crown Gem. I'm also on Pinterest. Only thing I'm not on is Instagram because I don't have any pictures, too many pictures. Well, I took some pictures. I think I'll take some pictures and put them up, you know, that I took, you know, of a bird and of nature. I like to do those kind of pictures. And just, you know, let me know that you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And I'm going to tell you why. Because in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 12, or 9 through 11, and I'm just paraphrasing, the Bible lets us know that we believe in our hearts and confess with our mouth that God raised Jesus from the grave, we shall be saved. And to me, that's a good morning cup of word. I don't know about you, but to me, that's a good morning cup of word. Amen, amen. Well, I've been your host. My name is Pastor Evangelist Deborah Tate. You've been listening to A Morning Cup of Word here on Live365.com, Station Crown Gem. And please be praying for our country, because this situation with Korea joining ranks with Putin is serious. It is serious. We have a lot of enemies, saints. We have a lot of enemies. We have people that literally can't stand us, and we don't know what's all going on. That's why we need to pray for our leaders, because we only know what they're putting on the news. We only know what they're letting us know. They're keeping secrets from us too. They talk about how people are keeping secrets from them, but they're keeping secrets from us too. And we don't know what all they know about us, because who's that guy that left and is living in Russia now that gave away all our top secrets? So we need to pray, saints. We need to pray. Because I believe that God's judgment is on United States, and we need to pray. And Congress, they got to start working with President Obama, even if they don't, you know. And I'm going to be honest with you, with the Israeli prime minister, what he's doing is not wise. It's not wise what he's doing. He needs to use more wisdom. I know that he wants to save his country, and I understand that. But he's got to use wisdom, because United States is turning against Israel. They're turning against Israel. So Benjamin. I can't pronounce his name. But you know who I'm talking about, the Israeli prime minister. He's got to use wisdom in dealing with President Obama, because it could backfire on him. Because right now you have the Democrats that are boycotting him coming here to talk to talk to Congress, and then they have to understand that United States is allies with Israel, and he has to use wisdom because there are black soldiers that will be spilling their lives, and some people may not want to fight for Israel if they see that he's not respecting a black president, and I'm keeping it real. So he needs really to use wisdom, and our Jewish sisters and brothers need to help us Christians maintain the morality of United States. They need to stand with us, because if United States morality goes down the toilet, there ain't going to be any Christians, and only Christians are going to love Israel because our Jesus came from there. Again, I've been your host. My name is Pastor Evangelist Deborah Tate. You've been listening to A Morning Cup of Word here on Live365.com station, The Crown Gem. And also join me at www.royaldiademministries.com, and I'll see you tomorrow. God bless you. Selah.